Governor Patrick, thanks for joining us.
I'm glad to be with
you.
Thank you.
We appreciate your time.
Thank you.
So it's a snowy day when we're recording this. As a former governor, do you ever have a little snow day PTSD in terms of this is one of these things? It's like you've got to get it done. People get ticked off about
this. Yeah, that's true. They do. And I, you know, as far as I can tell, everybody's doing what they need to do and doing the very best. We got up here in plenty of time. The roads were clear. But I remember that when I left office, someone told me, so that, you know, the term ends formally in early January. And I remember someone told me, you'll know that that you're done when on the first big snow you just wake up, look at the clock, and roll over.
Right? Because it's no longer, you know, having to be in it all the time. Right. I'm curious, is there a strategy involved with that that makes it all the way up to the governor, or is it just go get it and get it done? Because there's only so many resources and all that snow.
In terms of snow clearance and other emergencies, well, certainly in Massachusetts, I don't know how everybody does it, but I was very involved. And, you know, the I always got a briefing on the preparations, on the weather tracking, because it can often change. Remember once we called a weather emergency and it was a perfectly dry day the next day. And then we had other times where there were, you know, 100-year blizzards, and we shut down the Mass Pike and asked people to shelter in place, and that call was great. But yeah, you want to be involved because you're going to hear about it. You need to understand what the preparations are, and if we've thought hard about both the big stuff, but also just the requests of folks to check in on their elderly neighbors and folks who are shut in, just to make sure they're okay.
Yeah. Shifting gears a little bit here, in our cafe here, you talked about your educational experience, mm-hmm. being able to come to Massachusetts and get sort of a world-class education, even though you had those formative moments growing up in Chicago. Mm-hmm. What's your perspective, though, on school choice? We're seeing a lot of pushback right now from public school advocates, teachers' unions, from charter schools, those kinds of things. Do you think charter schools are part of the equation? And I guess, what does a Deval Patrick education policy look like, given your experience?
So first of all, I think education is an absolutely critical part of enabling the American dream, and I think the American dream is an absolutely critical part of this nation's promise. And I think a big part of why I'm in the race is because I want to be a part of rebuilding. Indeed, I want to lead the rebuilding of the American dream. In that respect, I think, look, we need quality education within reach of every child. You shouldn't have to leave the South Side of Chicago and come to Milton Academy on a scholarship to get a great education. And I got great elements on the South Side of Chicago in those big, broken, overcrowded, and under-resourced schools. But it still raises the question whether why we make the choice to let some schools be big, broken, overcrowded, and under-resourced. In my time as governor, remember, we had been on a journey of ed reform for a dozen years or so, but we still had persistent achievement gaps. And the kids, Adam, who were stuck in those gaps were poor children. They were children who had special needs, or kids who spoke English as a second language. And they're our kids, too. So rather than just celebrate the fact that we were number one overall in student achievement, we want to get to a truth, which is that every child can learn. They need different strategies, different ways, depending on their learning style and their needs. And I do believe there should be accountability no matter what. So, long way round to your question. I found that, and this was one example, that the greatest power of the governor, and I think it's true of the president, is the convening power, that you can bring to the table people who normally won't meet and collaborate. And we had the education policy wonks at the table, alongside business people, alongside charter advocates, alongside teachers unions, parent organizations. And we put the point was, forget about what's best for the adults. That's a lot of what the argument is. What is best for children? And what are the tools that we can make available that can be adapted for the child or that community that may be different over here than over there? And that Achievement Gap Act went into effect about a year and change later. I went to visit a school called the Orchard Gardens School, which was, before the act, described as one of the worst in the city. After a year or so of change of using all of these different tools, longer school day, after school opportunities, enrichment programs for some courses, smaller classrooms, and the resources that supported that, they'd gone from one of the worst in the city to one of the best in the state. And it was a proof point in real time about what happens when policy actually touches people. So my point is, we need a range of strategies. I am just kind of tired of the, it's got to be choice or district schools, it's got to be charters or no charters. It's got to be about the kid and about that community and how we assure that the whole child and his or her needs are met by the school environment and what complement of tools and skills and resources, not just ideas, but also resources, can make that difference.
People of color, the black community, it's always been a huge part of the successful coalition that elects Democrats, but they have more and more of a voice now and are playing more and more of a role in sort of the power dynamics, particularly in this primary. Mm. Is it a problem that there is not a candidate of color in that top tier right now, top four?
Well, you know, you talk about the top tier, and I say this respectfully. Not sure that if that's the indicator, tell us very much right now, and I don't think that one should presume that black or brown voters are going to choose a black or brown candidate simply because any more than I presume that a white voter is going to choose a white candidate just because that voter is white.
Do you wince a little bit, though, when you hear Vice President Biden say, "I come out of the black community in terms of my support"?
He's a friend of mine. He's had my back since he was chair of the Judiciary Committee, and I was a nominee for the Civil Rights Division, and we've continued to be friends. Any one of us at any given time is going to say something that makes someone else wince. So don't bait me. That's all I'm trying to say.
Sure.
I think, look, the African-American voter, like any other voter, like any other citizen for that matter, has to be paid attention to. And I mean not just asked at the time of election, but engaged in between elections. And you'll hear me talk a lot about how I want our campaign and our administration to be about everyone everywhere. And that's because, Adam, I think, having grown up on the south side of Chicago, having grown up as an African-American man and having traveled and experienced lots of different sectors in my personal and professional life, I know there are a whole lot of people who feel left out and left back by our politics. And if they feel attention is paid at all, it is at times like these, during campaigns, and then there's a huge sucking sound as soon as the campaign is over. I will bet you there are a whole lot of folks here in New Hampshire who feel that way.
Governor Patrick, thanks for joining us on the
show. Good to be with you.
We appreciate your time.
Thank you.